hearts laden with the notion that God spoke to them through their book, whichever book it is, Bible maybe, Quran maybe. It's just imagine men like that armed with nuclear weapons or germ warfare. It's darn frightening. Religion, the parent of civil discord and fanaticism. I think an enlightened man, Voltaire, had it right.
All right, Don, thank you for your input.
Bye.
And, you know, I would probably change that quote to fanatic religious or religion, fanatical religion, because, you know, you can try and point fingers at things like that all you want, but the fact of the matter is that there are so many more people who are uplifted by having a sense of something greater than themselves. For us, you know, we're Christians, we believe in the Bible, we believe it is the inspired word of God, we believe it speaks the truth, and all of those little things that were brought out were, you know, if you can take us any sentence, you know what you can say? You can say music is the root of all evil. Now that's a terrible thing to say because it's not true. But there is much of music that contributes to much of evil. So do you condemn all of music because of so much evil attached to so much of music? No. You just say, look, when you take it out of the context of being something uplifting and wonderful and beautiful and inspiring and motivating, you know, you lose it. We're looking, Jonathan, at a very specific time in prophecy that we live in. And we think we are living in the beginnings of these end times. And we think we're seeing that, you know, you had mentioned the, just like the travail upon a woman, the, mm-hmm. the birth pangs of a new age. And I think that we need to understand that according to Scripture, the difficulty happens, but not without a good final result and a good end reason. Let's take a look at a few scriptures that just help us to put that in perspective as we wrap this up.
John 5:28-29. Marvel not at this, for the hour cometh in which all that are in their tombs shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of judgment.
So, again, and we've quoted this scripture how many times? And you know, the other scripture I want to put in conjunction with this is that scripture we quoted about the restitution, the restoration of all things.
Yeah, Acts 3:19-21.
You put those two scriptures together, and you're talking about a resurrection and a time of restitution.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the restitution part, remember, starts with a taking down and a dismantling first, and then putting something together toward a positive end. And we have another call, Jonathan. We're going to have to make this call really fast because we're about out of time here.
Welcome to Christian Questions. This is Jonathan and Rick. Who are we speaking with?
Hi, this is Max.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you. I love what you guys do. I wish that you had more time so that I could pick Don's argument apart. maybe next week.
Maybe next week.
The difference, he brought up the Bible and the Quran. The difference between the two is that if you follow the tenets of the Bible, you will do good. In order to do good, you have to do what is not in the Quran. You have to do the opposite of what the Quran tells you to do. Because it tells of you to go out and destroy the infidels. It tells you to that all good Muslims will try to convert the world to Islam. And if they don't convert, then you have to kill them. That's exactly what it tells you to do. The big difference between the two is that the Bible tells you to do good and that the Quran tells you to do evil.
Well, and you know, there are Muslims who would beg to differ with you on that. But the point is that when you take the scriptures and you put them in context, it is a great, even if you don't want to dedicate yourself to them, what you're saying is it's a great textbook for life.
The Bible is, absolutely.
Yes, absolutely, positively. And
absolutely. It's the owner's manual for life.
Right, right, and that's a good way to put it.
And to touch on what Don said, to maybe pick Don apart a little bit, he's a pseudo-intellectual who can't, because he can't wrap his brain around what God teaches and the things that God leaves out of the Bible on purpose, he rejects it wholly.
Yeah, it's one of those things, and, you know, everybody's welcome to participate here. Listen, Mac, we need to run because our time is very short here this hour. Thank you for calling.
All right. Keep doing what you're doing. I love you guys.
All right. Thank you, Max. And Jonathan, as we continue, as we move forward here, we're winding down the program. Let's look at just a couple of prophecies that give us a sense of, we have 1 minute before the music. Okay, so we don't have time for a lot of prophecy here. Jeremiah 31:34 says, "They shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." Now see, Jonathan, you have to take that scripture and put it in the context of all those other scriptures that we were talking about. It is so important to put things in their proper context. In Isaiah chapter 35, we won't read the whole thing, but in verses 5 through 10, it talks about the eyes of the blind being opened, the ears of the deaf being unstopped, the lame man leaping as a deer, the tongue of the dumb singing, and the wilderness is breaking out with streams in the desert, and the parched ground becoming a pool. What a great picture. See, when we look at the tragedy of 9/11, one of the ways I deal with that personally is I have firm belief in a plan of God for the goodness of all mankind.
Yes.
And that just, when you can see something like that, Vic, whenever you're ready to start that, just start it. We're going to end the program, I'll tell you now, with a short rendition of a hymn called How Can I Keep From Singing? By Shidaisy, and it is a heartfelt picture of what this kingdom makes me think about.
How can I keep from singing? My life flows on in endless song. Above its lamentation, I hear the far off hymn that hails a new creation through all the tumult and the strife. I hear the music ring, it finds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart. A fountain never springing, all things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from singing?